So I want to show you how to do Bluetooth in React Native, and the way I discovered to be most suitable to handle the event-driven nature of Bluetooth. But shortly about me, I'm Martin. By the way, the timer is not running, just in case you want me to stick to the time. Yeah, thanks. I'm Martin. I live here in Berlin, and I work as a JavaScript engineer. And I'm currently doing Node, React, and React Native stuff at a company called Testo. And because I assume most of you won't know Testo, I quickly explain why that is important for this talk. Because you see, Testo's developing these kind of devices. So for example, the one on the left is a exhaust measuring device. So you plug that into a chimney of a factory, for example, and it will give you enough data to know if you are actually within the environmental compliance of the country you are in. The other picture is a sensor probe for temperature measurements, and that's very often used in food compliance to just make sure any food you eat, for example, the fast food chain or at a canteen, is not full of bacteria. And all of these devices basically have nowadays Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. And for Wi-Fi, that's pretty easy. They talk to the cloud and you get the data basically instantly. But for Bluetooth, you need a companion app. And in the past, we have built these companion apps usually with Objective-C or Java. But recently, we realized, well, we are doing a lot of React on the web. Why not do it on React Native also with the apps? And that's how I came to do Bluetooth in React Native. So when I say Bluetooth, I'm actually talking of Bluetooth Low Energy here. And that is basically a protocol called GET. And GET has four entities you should know about if you ever handle Bluetooth. And that's client, server, characteristic, and service. Client and server is basically what you already know from the web. So the client is your phone, the server is your Bluetooth device, and one connects to another. And once they start exchanging information, those information live in characteristics. For example, one characteristic pretty common on Bluetooth devices is the manufacturer name or, for example, the battery level. And these characteristics are grouped together in services to make stuff a little bit easier for us as developers. So you can imagine, for example, a characteristic for temperature readings, which you would search for if you want to read the temperature of a certain piece of meat, for example. And the library I'm using for Bluetooth in React Native is React Native BLE PLX. It's a pretty straightforward library. You do yarn add, and if you're on iOS, that's pretty it. If you're on Android, you want to set up permissions to actually use Bluetooth. Otherwise, you will run in a lot of exceptions and, well, basically spend the afternoon debugging. If you look at the documentation of this library, you will realize most of the functions either take a callback or provide a promise in the end, because as I said, Bluetooth is highly asynchronous. And after I implemented the first prototypes, I realized just with pure React, that's not really too good readable, it's not good maintainable. So I started looking into what to use for the more asynchronous stuff, and I concluded that I want to use streams here. So there's a couple of stream libraries within the space of JavaScript. Xstream is the one I chose because I like it for its simplicity, but that also means that most of the stuff you will do with any other streaming library does basically work also. And I'm not sure if all of you have worked with streams before, so I'm gonna quickly explain the basic concept. Just imagine you have a timeline, and in the stream, objects appear over time and disappear. And we can, for example, look at the talks in this conference, like being on a stream. And like with these talks, you will not be able to actually watch two at the same time. So you need to be at either one or the other talk. And that's the same in streams. You always get one object at a time. And once that's gone, it's basically gone. And the beauty about streams is actually that we can run operations on streams, like this filter, for example. And that, again, like filters and arrays, for example, will give us a new stream that has just the items we want. And for example, we can filter for just the events that happen here in the East Hall. So much about streams. Let's look into Bluetooth. Again, we will start with a timeline. The first thing you will always do, basically in any language on any phone, when you want to do Bluetooth, is you need to watch the actual state of the Bluetooth adapter within your phone. So that's basically the little piece of hardware that is doing all the frequency stuff and so on you don't want to care about. And it obviously has stayed like powered on and powered off, but there's also quite important one called unauthorized. And even if you have set up the permissions within your manifest, for example, as long as you don't have permissions, you will always get error messages when you try to do something. So pretty important to watch that state. Otherwise, again, you're going to debug a lot if you don't pay attention. And we can monitor the state with a function from BLE PLX that is called onStateChange. And instead of providing a callback here, I call a function from Xtreme called extreme_from_callback. What that will basically do is turn this function into a stream. So we get a stream that will first usually show unknown, because whenever you start an app with a Bluetooth before the library is initialized, it will not know the Bluetooth adapter state. And once everything is done, you hopefully get powered on. And again, as I said, it's pretty good to know during development the state of your Bluetooth adapter. So let's assume we actually want to put some text into our app to just show the Bluetooth adapter. Of course, you know how to display text in React Native, but a stream is not a state. So how do we actually put the stream into our user interface? And the solution is hooks again. There's a couple of different implementations of hooks called useStream. They basically all do the same. You can just pick any. But the way it works is you plug in your stream and an initial value, and it just returns the value of the current element in the stream. And then you can just basically put that in your components. So again, the adapter state is maybe interesting from a development perspective, but not that relevant for users. So let's actually look on how to show devices. Like, the next step obviously would be to search for devices we want to use. So we basically take the same stream of the states and just filter for powered on states, because that's the only one that are relevant from now on. And what we will do again is we will take another function called startDeviceScan and create another stream from these callbacks. Unfortunately, as you see here, we actually get a stream of devices. That's just the case because we have run map on a stream and afterwards created a stream also. So Xtreme has a function called flatten, which can just flatten that down to a stream of devices. And we're ready to show that as, for example, buttons in our user interface. So we now get a list of devices we can connect to. But the actual interesting thing is going to be the characteristics on these devices, because only that way we can read or write information to the device. And so the first step would be to assume that if the user clicks on one of the buttons, we have a stream with exactly that device in it. Let's call it selected device stream. And we will run a couple of map operations basically on the stream. So the first one is connecting to the device. Now, you will see that I'm, apart from connecting here, also stop scanning. That is specifically relevant to Android, because most Android phones will not allow you to connect to any device, basically, if you have not stopped scanning before. So again, one of these things, if you know that already, it saves you quite some time on the debugging. After that, we will call a second map operation with a function called discover all services and devices. And that is basically specific to our BLE PLX library. So the library will not know the existing services and characteristics after connecting. So if you just try to access them without discovering them before, you will again just get error messages because the library thinks they are not there. In both cases, we in the end get back the device object, so the stream stays completely the same. But once we have done these steps, we can actually query the services. Now, the services will be an array of services, actually, which means we have one object on the stream with an array inside, which is not exactly suitable for streams. So we do again a combination of flatten and, in this case, stream from array to turn that array into a stream of services. And now we're actually pretty close to the characteristics array, because we can do the same again. Every service has a characteristics method that will return arrays of characteristics, which we then flatten down. And then our stream looks like this, and we get any amount of characteristics. I have displayed 3 here. Usually you will get easily 50 or 60, actually, on most devices. So there's one thing I, for the sake of simplicity, have left out so far. I explained that you can easily read from characteristics or write to that. And I also said that most of the time you will be easily able to, for example, get data like battery level and so on from that. But there's a lot of devices that are more complex. And that's just due to the nature that most of like previous Bluetooth communication, or also like USB connection, works fully serial, meaning you get two channels, one for reading, one for writing. And on these channels, you send binary messages. And a lot of devices actually simulate that by using the characteristics. So you get one characteristic for reading data and one for writing data. And that's actually how also most of these measuring devices work, I've showed you before. And when I revised the code for preparing the talk, I realized the protocol we are speaking there is proprietary, and I kind of can't show it here. So you might realize the buttons are called like Star Wars robots, so I will assume now I'm speaking an imaginary protocol with imaginary Star Wars robots, which happen to work very similar to the one I used to implement. So let's assume we have a BBA robot here, and we want to have that roll around the room. So to control that, we just add 4 more buttons with arrows for all the directions. And now we can again assume with the buttons that we have a stream of these buttons, and that stream would look something like that. You see all the 4 arrows and a stop symbol, the basic idea being that when you press the button, it sends the arrow, and when you release the button, it will send the stop signal, so the robot is not crashing in any walls. Unfortunately, these are symbols. You really can't send that to a robot. So we need to convert that into something more technical. I've chosen vectors here. So basically, the first parameter is the speed. The second one is the angle. We're going with a fixed speed of 80 here, and then the angles. And to stop, we just set the speed to 0. Again, that's already technical, but it's not yet binary. So let's use some method called roll and turn that into actual binary packages. So now we are technically done and could send this information off to the robot. Unfortunately, there's one specific about BLE PLX. It does not use byte arrays, but instead base64 encoded strings. And so we need to actually encode that with base64, which is slightly annoying during development, but works fine. So now how do we send that to the robot? We had the stream of characteristics, and we can fit on that for a specific characteristic for sending off stuff. And then we can use a method called combine. And you can see on the top timeline, what it does is basically it takes both streams and combines the object together. So whenever there's a new event coming on one stream, it will memorize the previous event on the other stream and combine them together to be a new event. And we're going to need that because once you register a listener on this new stream, you can actually take the characteristic for sending and the command you want to send, and basically use the write with response method here to send that around. That's all pretty nice, and we can send now data to the robot, but actually the robot is never sending us data back. And if you imagine, for example, it would run into a wall and you are standing around the corner, you wouldn't even realize. So let's implement some collision detection. Basically saying if the robot runs in a wall, we can show this emoji just for the user to know. And the way we do that is, again, we take the characteristic stream and we pick the characteristic for reading data. And again, we use xtreme from callback, but this time we call a method called monitor on the characteristic. And what monitor is basically doing, it will give you all incoming packages into our stream. And that will look something like this. You realize again, we are at base 64, so we will need to decode that. And now we need to do some interpretation on these packages. So it's pretty fair to assume actually that there's going to be more packages than just collision detection. So for example, I don't know, the robot notifies about its battery level or Wi-Fi signal strings or whatever. So let's assume the third byte in the binary array is an identifier for the package type. So what we can do basically is pick the third byte and return that on the stream. If you haven't worked with DataView, it's a pretty nice and built-in JavaScript class for handling binary data. And that's basically our collision stream. We can just filter for the packages we need, which show us a collision, and again, plug that into our user interface to show the emoji. Now, when I was researching again for this talk, I pretty soon found there is actually a BB-8 robot you can control via Bluetooth. It's made by a company called Sphero. You might know them from these balls that are usually used for playing with cats. And it works pretty fine, and by coincidence, it exactly works with the code I showed you before. Unfortunately, it's, well, the bottle is bigger actually than the robot, and you see it running around the stage here. So I made a video, but if you're going to be later at the party or grab me later at the conference, I have it with me, and you can take a look, play around with that if you want. Yeah, let me show you the video. Let's see on which screen this. Yeah, of course, on the wrong one. Give me one moment to left, right. Oh, that looks good. So you can see the app has booted up, the robot was discovered, and once it turned purple, it actually connected. Now I'm running it a little bit around. I'm actually getting quite confused because I'm having the phone in one hand and the tablet in the other one, and you see I crashed it into the wall and the emoji appears. So let's see if I can get back here. Here we go. And that's basically it. I put the code on GitHub for the robot, but if you any device you have basically is fine to trying on Bluetooth, and feel free to try that out. I hope you have, if you haven't worked with streams, at least see that it's possible for some applications to use streams. And yeah, thanks for watching and enjoy the rest of the day.